Wes Anderson. The man, the myth, the legend. You can say many things about Wes, such as he likes symmetry, he loves boomer rock, he's never made a bad movie, admit it, you loved The Darjeeling Limited, or that you can't believe he's from Texas. But something upon which everyone can agree is that he carefully crafts each of his films. There's a special quality to each of his movies where nothing feels accidental or out of place. His films feel handmade, as if they're taking place in a highly controlled diorama. It lends his films a semi-surreal and fantastical feeling. They occupy a space between fantasy in crushing reality. Here's the thing. If his films were just nifty or cool to look at, but had no substance, he wouldn't be as highly regarded as he is. His films' aesthetics are wonderful, but the way these quote-unquote twee aesthetics clash with his darker stories and themes produces a unique feeling within the audience. His films are melancholic. They focus on the failure of families, on death, depression, passion, personal failure, ambition, and much more. For as fake as his films can look, emotionally, they're firmly grounded in reality. Today, let's take a look at Moonrise Kingdom, one of my favorite of his films. How did he do it? This is not going to be an analysis video in a traditional sense, but a look at an artist at work. For me, there's a whole new level of appreciation I gain for a filmmaker when I learn how they made their movies. Hopefully, you all will appreciate the care and craft Wes put into making Moonrise Kingdom, and if you're a filmmaker like myself, maybe you can learn a thing or two that you can use in your next film. So if you don't mind spoilers and a small dose of demystification, let's begin. You know how bands often talk about their influences when they're trying to find their sounds? Well, directors discuss their cinematic influences with their collaborators before they shoot a movie. There's not a single Wes Anderson film, to my knowledge, that isn't influenced by Francois Truffaut. But two films come to the forefront when speaking about Moonrise Kingdom: Waris Hussein's Melody and Ken Loach's Blackjack. Both films focus on young lovers who wish to marry each other. In Blackjack, Belle is trying not to be sent to a madhouse, and Tolley seeks to run away with her by sailing away to work with his uncle at sea. If you watch the films next to Moonrise Kingdom, it's easy to see the influences. A few other influences to note are Charolata, which inspired Susie's use of binoculars, and Escape from Alcatraz, which Wes had Jared Gilman watch to inform his character of Sam Shikuski. Using Escape from Alcatraz to inform Shikuski's character plays right into Anderson's signature tonal dissonance, as Sam, a scrawny 12-year-old khaki scout, embodies or attempts to embody an adult Clint Eastwood character. It infuses a comical sense of self-confidence, but we get moments when he lowers the tough guy act, and we see that he's just been a kid all along. Also, I can't not mention that the beach dance scene is taken, stolen, borrowed, inspired by whatever from the dance scene in Terrence Malick's Badlands, which is also a film about two young lovers on the run, except they're serial killers. I don't recall Sam and Susie killing anyone, even if Redford deserved it. And I want to bring up Bob Balaban, the man we all know as the guy who stiffed John Voight in Midnight Cowboy. His character is both a narrator looking back on the film as a past event, and a character who interacts with the other characters in their own point in time. He's a surrealist fourth wall breaking character, a byproduct of Wes's love for Buñuel. What most Wes Anderson fans love to talk about in relation to his films are his aesthetic choices. Now, Moonrise Kingdom definitely feels like a Wes Anderson movie, there's no doubt about it, but he shot the film in a much different fashion than his other movies. Let's start with the most obvious example of this, and this was Wes's decision to shoot on Super 16mm film, a format he hadn't made a movie on before or since. Well, he shot his original Bottle Rocket short on 16mm, and there is a slight difference between 16 and Super 16, but I'll save that for another video. Shooting on Super 16 accomplished a few things in terms of his style and the production workflow. For one, modern film stocks are much sharper than they used to be, so a Super 16 frame now is generally not as grainy as a Super 16 frame from 1980. In fact, some Super 16 images now can be mistaken for 35mm film, especially the slower stocks. Wes and his DP Bob Yeoman shot the film on 200T film stock, which, with an ASA of 200, is considered rather slow by today's standards. But this particular stock is also thought to be one of the more versatile film stocks. The slow speed of the stock keeps the grain down, but Super 16mm film has this magical feel to it. It's like it automatically transfers you to somewhere in the past, in this case, the 1960s. Super 16 cameras are also smaller than their 35mm counterparts, obviously. Bob Yeoman used both the Auton XCR and the Auton A Minima for the shoot. The A Minima was the first Super 16 only camera, and it stands out from the other cinema cameras in that, for handheld shots, it's meant to be held in a more underslung position, sort of like how you would hold a video camera. Most other cinema cameras rest on your shoulders. The result of this design decision of the A Minima in Moonrise Kingdom is that when Wes and Bob used this camera for the handheld shots, shots, the camera recorded the film at the eye levels of the children, which subconsciously allows the audience to see the film from their perspective. But that's not to say that the Auton XTR is some massive camera either. It's not. I actually have some experience shooting on this camera, and it's an amazing camera for anyone who wants to get into Super 16 filmmaking. But getting back to the point, we all know that Wes Anderson loves his handheld shots, dollies, and whip pans, and it's simply easier to pull off all these camera movements when the camera is lighter. And considering that Moonrise Kingdom's set was scaled down from his other films, the smaller, more lightweight camera setups allowed them to generally move a lot faster on set. Some people on the set of Moonrise Kingdom likened the set to feeling like summer camp, which I'm sure helped put the actors in the appropriate mindset. There weren't trailers on set. Instead, they used scout tents. Actors were also expected to show up to set in costume and camera ready, so the actors put on their own makeup and costumes at home. And for the first couple weeks, the set was incredibly small. It was just Wes, Bob, a stripped down crew, and the two leads in the woods. He scheduled the film shoot so that the film ramped up in size as it went along, allowing Jared Gilman, Kara Hayward, and the other child actors to get comfortable on set before they were surrounded by a bunch of people. Wes also created the scenes in previs so that he was able to show his actors exactly how he imagined each scene, so they understood his vision and how they fit into it. Wes's consideration for his child actors' well-being fostered their performances, all of which were great. And if any of the adult actors are somehow watching this, you were great too.
Especially you, Edward. I mean, Scoutmaster Ward.
I know Wes casted you because you look like someone from a Norman Rockwell painting, which you do, but I didn't know before this movie how much sheer, raw, unadulterated scout leader energy you exude. You were born for this role. Wes, his VFX team, and his production designer Adam Stockhausen blended a mixture of practical sets and effects with CGI. Wes estimated that 80% of the shots in the film had some sort of VFX work. Now, most of the cases of VFX are pretty simple, painting out wires and dolly tracks, as well as compositing set decoration onto the screen, stuff you wouldn't notice. Some are more obvious, like when Scoutmaster Ward jumps across the flooded canal with Harvey Keitel on his back, which in reality was a Harvey Keitel backpack. My favorite case of VFX in the film is the lightning strike. Initially, they tried to film the scene practically, but the end result didn't feel right. So, the solution was to photograph Jared Gilman in multiple positions against a green screen, and then overlay the photographs of his body onto the frame, treating him like a stop-motion puppet. And the lightning was painted on too, but that's not a surprise. But here is a surprise. The treehouse was real. It needed wires to stay up, but it was totally real. And even though people think that Wes likes to cut his sets in half after that one shot in The Life Aquatic, it's generally not very practical. All the house interiors were filmed in a studio. I'm using the term loosely. It's the editing of the shots that produce this dollhouse effect. And it's the editing that brings the film together. Wes maintains a steady rhythm throughout. It's perhaps in the rhythm that Wes is the most tyrannical, if you can ever call him tyrannical. He does resort to line reading so that the actors know how to deliver his lines with the correct timing. But hey, Edward Norton says he likes Wes's line reading, so who are we to complain? Moonrise Kingdom is a prime example of a movie made with a clear and distinct vision. Everything, the actors, the cinematography, the editing, the sets, the costumes, and the effects come together into a compelling and cohesive whole. Everything serves to create Wes's childhood fantasy. And thankfully, we're invited to spend some time in it. If you like this video, please like, comment, and subscribe. Below, I have a link to my interview with Jared Gilman. He played as Sam Shikuski, the main character in Moonrise Kingdom. It's a long interview, and we go into a lot more depth in that interview. So if you're more interested in, you know, more specific kind of things, check that out. And I will see you all in the next video.